through the season of Advent. Please join us in beginning our worship services with prayer and contemplation, observing the incense that thickens the air, reminding us that the Holy Spirit is with us. Observe the lit candles on the Advent wreath. Help us mark time as we anticipate Christ's new birth in our hearts and our lives. Join in the singing of the Tese refrain that calls our attention to the ongoing need for justice and peace for all God's children.
The third Advent candle is a symbol of God's love for us and for our love for one another. For God rejoices over us with gladness and renews us in divine love. God exalts over us with singing and turns our shame to praise.
God be with you. Let us pray. Stir up your power, O Lord, and with great might come among us. And because we are sorely hindered by our sins, let your bountiful grace and mercy speedily help and deliver us. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory now and forever. Amen.
The first lesson. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me. Because the Lord has anointed me, he has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and to release to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit. They will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord to display his glory, They shall build up the ancient ruins. They shall raise up the former devastations. They shall repair the ruined cities, the devastations of many generations. For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrongdoing. I will faithfully give them their recompense. I will make an everlasting covenant with them. Their descendants shall be known among the nations, and their offspring among the peoples. All who see them shall acknowledge that they are a people whom the Lord has blessed. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My whole being shall exult in my God, for he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with a robe of righteousness, and as a bridegroom decks himself with a garland, and as a bride adorns herself with jewels, for as the earth brings forth its shoots, and as a garden causes what is sown in it to spring up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring up before all nations. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the people. And now we will read the canticle together. My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on his lowly servant. From this day all generations will call me blessed. The Almighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. He has mercy on those who fear him. In every generation, he has shown the strength of his arm. He has scattered the proud with their counsel. He has cast down the mighty from their throne and has lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has come to the help of his servant Israel, for he has remembered his promise of this. Glory to our fathers, to Abraham and his children forever. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
A reading from 1 Thessalonians. Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the Spirit. Do not despise the words of prophets, but test everything. Hold fast to what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. May the God of peace himself sanctify you entirely, and may your spirit and soul and body be kept sound and blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do this. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the people. Thanks be to God.
Oh, Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. This is the testimony given by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny it, but confessed, "I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" He said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah said." Now they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him, "Why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal." This took place in Bethany, across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord
Christ. This is the second week in a row we've heard the story of John the Messenger. Last week, we heard Mark's gospel naming John as the messenger referred to by the prophet Isaiah, the messenger who will go ahead of the Lord, preparing a straight path in the wilderness, the place where life is hard and the way forward is hard to see. This week, we hear John's gospel naming him as a witness whose purpose is to testify to the light. The priest and the Levites come from Jerusalem to ask John who he is. He responds, "I am not the Messiah." They keep at him, ask him if he's Elijah or a prophet. Each time he responds with what he knows to be true, that he is the messenger sent to prepare the way. I'm sorry.
Need some water?
No, I just needed to clear my...
They keep adding, asking. Just go back and...
How's that with you?
Fine, yeah.
They keep at him, asking... One more time. They keep at him, asking if he's Elijah or a prophet. Each time he responds with what he knows to be true, that he is the messenger sent to prepare the way. That seems so simple and straightforward, doesn't it? John just tells the truth about who he is. Why is that so important that we need to hear it 2 weeks in a row? John is telling the truth about who he is. That's all, and that's everything. I suggest to you that knowing the truth about who we are is one of the biggest tasks of our lives. Knowing the truth about who we are is the key to fruitful relationship with our individual selves, with the people around us, and with God. It's a task that never ends, but always brings us closer to the deep peace at the center of all creation. I may be speaking only for myself, but it seems to me that the hardest part of that knowing involves coming to awareness that we are not God. Not even God with a little bitty G. We each tend to believe that our worldview is the most accurate, our opinions are the most informed, our knowledge of the world and its working is most comprehensive. We speak for God. We interpret God's actions to each other. And we tell God what it is that God ought to do. It's hard to separate ourselves from the notion that God is a lot like us, only maybe a little bit bigger. But here comes John, showing us how to do that, making it really clear that he's not the Messiah. He's not the breath of God, the promised anointed one. He is not Elijah come again to put people on the right track. He's not even a prophet come to call the people to remember the way. He's the messenger sent to prepare the way for the one who comes. And so are we. Last week, the first words of Mark's gospel told us it was the beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. This week, John's gospel reminds us that the work of the messenger is to be present in the wilderness, to be witness to the radiance present in the most difficult moments, to prepare the path that leads us to the one who baptizes with the Spirit. All of us know about the wilderness. We've been there, and we know we're going there again. There have been days in this year when a nice calm wilderness might have felt like a good alternative to the chaos, suffering, and tribulation that's going on in our world. But we are messengers, and John's story reminds us that we have a story to tell, particularly in times like these. In the midst of confusion, grief, and sorrow, we have seen the path grow straight. We have seen the hand of God at work in our lives. We have seen and experienced moments of grace beyond our imagining. And we are here to bear witness to the world through our presence and our actions. We are not God, but we know God, and that makes all the difference. Knowing God helps us keep grace at the center of our lives and awareness, and helps us find the path when the road seems impossibly difficult. Knowing God prepares us to carry the message. Knowing God helps us live in a way that gives hope to the world. Knowing God gives us courage to do our best every day to live into our baptismal covenant promises, to seek and serve Christ in all persons, to strive for justice and peace among all people, and to respect the dignity of every human being. That is our story. That is our message. And each of us is called to carry that message into this world. As Christmas approaches, I invite you to a time of reflection, a time of preparation, a time to prepare our hearts for the one who is always with us and who comes to be with us yet again. I invite you to reflect on who you are and on how the Christ is being incarnated in your life and your witness. I invite you to listen in these next days for the voice that speaks in your heart and to join in welcoming the one who comes to us in all the times of our lives. Come, Lord Jesus. Oh, come, oh, come, Emmanuel.
I now invite you to stand and join me in reaffirming your faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. With all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray, saying, Christ, have mercy.
For the peace from above, for the loving kindness of God, and for the salvation of our souls, let us pray, Christ, have mercy. For the peace of the world, for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all peoples, let us pray, Christ, have mercy. For Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, the presiding bishop of the Episcopal Church, Scott, our bishop, and for all bishops, ministers, and lay leaders, let us pray, Christ, have mercy. For Donald, our president, Joe, our president-elect, Greg, our governor, and Betsy, our mayor, for those who serve in the military, and for all first responders, let us pray, Christ, have mercy. For the good earth which God has given us, and for the wisdom and will to conserve it, let us pray, Christ, have mercy. For healthcare providers and support staff worldwide, and the patients in their care, for the aged and infirm, for refugees and victims, for the sick and the suffering, and for those we now name.
For Jean,
let us pray, Christ have mercy. For all who have died in the hope of the resurrection, and for all the departed, let us pray, Christ have mercy. For the deliverance from all danger, violence, oppression, and degradation, let us pray, Christ have mercy. In the communion of the Blessed Virgin Mary and all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to God. To thee, Almighty God.
We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through the grace of Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The peace of Christ be always with you. May the God of hope fill you. May the God of joy overflow you. May the God of peace pour you into the world. May God Almighty, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, bless and keep you now and forever. Amen. Amen. Go in peace, seeking justice for all God's children. Thanks be to God.